settling in for a quiet Christmas at home here in Ontario. We're getting ready to go into lockdown. So we're all going to do our part by, you know, roasting a turkey breast instead of a full bird or whatever. I mean, it's better to sacrifice a piece of turkey than sacrifice grandma, right? So let's all do our part. I see some family from Newfoundland. That's a great gift to see right before Christmas. I see my brother Lloyd. Those of you who come from Great Britain might know the song, Lloyd George is me brother is Lloyd George. That's true. My brother is Lloyd George. And I had an uncle, Winston Churchill, too, God rest his soul. And I see my great niece, or my niece Sarah is there. Well, she is a great niece, but she's not my great niece, if you know what I mean. I'll come rolling in. Hey, it's one of our performers, Lynn Smythe, with her daddy, Jim. So, and another one of our performers, Mark. Hey, with beautiful Greg. And so it's good to see you all. Glad you all could come and join us. Yeah. There's a, don't know how many we'll have on the call, but we'll have a number of people watching this live on you on the live stream as well on YouTube. Pamela, I'm already making you weep. I apologize. Where's there we go. Still have some folks coming in, so we'll just wait a little bit before we start. Still coming in. Hello, everybody, and welcome. We're glad you all take time tonight. The sun has gone down. We've moved past the fourth Sunday of Advent. We're right into that time of getting ready now for our beautiful Christmas celebrations. While we're waiting for everybody to come in, this is as good a time as any for me to remind folks that are, as you know, here in Ontario, at least in this part of Ontario, we've moved to online worship. And so on Christmas Eve, our service will be online. It'll be a service of lessons and carols. And it's taking place at 4 p.m. On Christmas Eve, on Thursday. If you sign on a little early, you may get there early enough for a little bit of some caroling that David's going to do ahead of time. So by all means, feel free to join us as soon as you want to on Christmas Eve. I mean, you can come very early and you won't find anything, but we're not doing Zoom. It's a live stream to the parish's YouTube channel and to the parish's Facebook page. So either of those will get you straightened out there for our Christmas Eve service. All right, we're at just 2 minutes after, and we have a full program tonight, folks. Lots of music. I sent out a program, and I think Morgan has posted it into the chat function here as well, if you want to sort of know what's coming up next. I want to just give you a little bit of instruction for those of you who are participating. There's a number of people tonight who are going to share stories or readings or poetry or prayers. Live. When it comes your turn, I will be asking you to unmute. So watch for that when you're coming up. And like I said, there might be a little bit. I'll introduce each of the recorded pieces just so that you've time to mute your camera and so on. And then you'll be able to go from there. Oh, look at that. There's Barney. Hello, Barney. And hello, Vicky. Good to see you. So we're gonna get started. I want to begin by offering this prayer of acknowledgement. I know we're gathered from many places and locales from the world over. Look, hello, Diane Pike from America. I hope you're doing okay over there. We've all been praying for you too. Yeah, thumbs down, I know. But hey, the 20th is coming. That's at least hopeful. So I want to acknowledge the land that we are upon here from the place from which we're broadcasting, if you can use that word. We're live casting this this event. Creator, you have made all people of every land, and it is our responsibility to give thanks and respect for those who first occupied this land we are upon. These are the traditional lands of the Anishinaabeg, Haudenosaunee, Lenawaupeuk, and Attawandaran peoples. These lands are connected with the London Township and Somber Treaties of 1796 and the Dish with One Spoon Covenant Wampum. This land continues to be home to diverse Indigenous people, whom we recognize as contemporary stewards of the land and vital contributors of our society. We are thankful for the gifts of the people of the land. We offer you our respect. We offer our respect to you and to the ancestors of this land who may be here interred. Creator, as we gather tonight from many places, let us be of good mind to reconcile the mistreatment of this land and all of our lands and to those who have been displaced. With thankful and respectful hearts, we pray in your name, your Son, the Peacemaker, and the Sacred Three. Amen. So just a word about what tonight is. Less a church service than an opportunity to hear some prayer, some poetry, some scripture, perhaps, indeed, for sure, not perhaps, and some music. Some of it religious, some of it just beautiful and religious because it's beautiful, sacred, and I hate the word secular, but you know what I mean. It's a little bit of everything. And the title, Ragged Robes and Rabbit Skins is taken from the Huron Carol, which you will hear at the very early part of tonight's celebration. And it's Canada's oldest Christmas song, written probably in 1642 by Saint Jean de Brébeuf, who was a Jesuit missionary among the Hurons in this part of the world. And it's a beautiful song in that it really represents an acknowledgement of the Gitche Manitou, the God, the Creator. And we hear in the second verse, in terms of the scene of the birth of Christ being placed here in this place, on this land, sounding like this. Within a lodge of broken bark, the tender babe was found. A ragged robe of rabbit skin enwrapped his beauty round. But as the hunter braves drew nigh, the angel song rang loud and high. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born in excelsis gloria. So that's the spirit with which we gather. I give thanks to all of you for being here. And let me say at the outset, thank you to the many performers and artists and storytellers who've offered themselves freely for tonight. And may we enter into this with the spirit of knowing that the light of Christ will dispel all darkness, whatever it is we feel right now at this time of year, wherever we are in the midst of this pandemic, we know that God is with us. We will begin with a reading of Psalm 147.
Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God, for he is gracious. And a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem, gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord, and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the downtrodden. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre.
I'm muted. Thank you, Catherine Ann. I'll see you later at home. Our first piece of music for the evening comes from two of our youngest here in our church, two young disciples who exercise their ministry with the joy that is in all in their hearts and in the expression of their own faith journey. And so I give to you Angels We Have Heard on High by Kate and Amelia. Thank you both for that beautiful music, and our love is with you all right now. God, whether with a piano or an old kazoo or a violin or a pair of spoons, or whether classical or country, whether solo or with a friend, we would sing to you, joyous heart, as we wait to celebrate your coming to us in ragged robes and in rabbit skins. Now I give you our own David Weaver with the Huron Carol. Bear with me.
Was in the moon of winter time, when all the birds had fled, that mighty Geechee Manitou sent angel choirs instead. Before their light, the stars grew dim, and wandering hunters heard by him. Jesus, your King is born. Jesus is born. He exhales his glory.
Jesus unrolled the scroll and found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. In compassion and love, God is with us." Amen.
Just to remind you once again that as I start these videos, if you would shut your video off, that will perhaps help with the bandwidth and the lagging. This piece is O Come, O Come, Emmanuel, and it is from our very own Josie Vitaveen, who plays beautifully, and we're glad to have her offer music with us tonight.
Let us like Mary, endure criticism and rejection, if only to be pregnant with the life of God in us, always waiting, anticipating the day of birth, the day when we see you and know you, the day when we know God has burst through into our lives, conceived within us from a power beyond us, the day of your coming into our lives. Let us accept the truth. God with us means the humbling of the proud and the raising up of the lowly. Let us welcome the truth. God with us means freedom for the oppressed and release for the captives. Let us proclaim the truth. God with us means the breaking through of God's dawn into our shadow lives. Let us rejoice in the truth. God with us means God dwells amongst us and within us. Let us look upon one another as houses of God's presence and so share peace.
This prayer is called They Ought to Know Jesus. Jesus came to give himself in love to the people, to be among them, knowing their troubles and meeting them there, each in their own wilderness, man and woman and child, raising them up or bringing them down and showing them a path to tread back to the true community of God's kingdom. In the love of Jesus, we see and know the truth that God is with us. We all ought to know Jesus. Pardon me. We all ought to know Jesus. One of my classmates at St. George's High School in Dildo, Newfoundland, is a man named Dean Reed. And Dean is an incredible singer. You can find him in the summertime in Newfoundland, giving tours out on the harbor or running his coffee shop there. But he spends his winters in Saint-Félix-de-Valois. I bastardized that pretty good, but in Quebec, northeast of Montreal. And it's from there that he sent us two recordings this week. And this was the first of those. It's called Everybody Ought to Know.
I hope you're all doing well. Thank you, Kevin, for asking me to do this. It's always a privilege for sure. And if there's anything else I could do to help, excuse the eye. I had something in my eye a couple days ago, and putting drops and everything in. So this next song is another great song I enjoy doing, especially Christmas time. It's not only a Christmas song, but something everybody ought to know. And when we're going around my hometown in Dildo, Newfoundland, going around to the older folks' home, we often do this with maybe 8, 10, 12 people singing to them. And hope you all enjoy it. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know who Jesus is. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. The lily of the valley, he's the bride. fairest of 10,000. Everybody ought to know. Let's do it one more time. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Everybody ought to know. Everybody, have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. May God bless. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean. Dean, it was 365 days yesterday since Dean was back in Dildo, and it's been over 365 days since I've been back in White Wing. So Dean and I were commiserating this week as we put this together about how we both miss getting back home. And I know there's some family on here right now from Newfoundland as well, and perhaps some folks who know Dean, some of Dean's family. And so hello to all of you out there. We're certainly praying for all of you. And we ask you, as we're about to go into more of a lockdown here, to keep us in your prayers as well. One of the things we know about this time of year is it can be incredibly difficult for those who are grieving or facing difficulty at home. And so this next little segment of a prayer and a piece of music is really directed there for us to realize that there are those among us and around us who need our care, our love, and our support, because we certainly know that Christmas has a way of tinging grief. And this year, especially with COVID layered upon that, it's made grief even that much more intense, particularly for those who are feeling isolated and alone. In a particular way, I want to hold up Fred, who's in England right now. He flew back for his father's death. He's a parishioner here, and he's arrived in London to find himself in the midst of what is about to become a very serious lockdown with travel restrictions and everything. So we pray for his safe return to us and for him as he wraps up the remembrance of his dad. But we certainly remember all of you out there who are holding grief in your hearts at this time. God of the ages, all around us we see the lights of Christmas. We hear the sounds of joyful celebration. At times, we struggle with how to respond. As the nights have grown longer, sadness and emptiness, loneliness and pain wrap around our hearts, meant for many of us. We aren't always able to put into words, O God, that which causes us to feel melancholy rather than the joy that we hear expressed around us. And so we turn to you, O God, with our pain, and we lay it at your feet. For some, a loved one has died. For others, a friend has moved away. For others yet are sitting by a bedside saying goodbye to a cherished loved one. Others have lost a job, a cherished dream, or a sense of hope. Some of us are feeling worried, trapped, insecure, adrift, or alone. Some of us are fearful for what will happen in this pandemic time. Some of us are grieving what might have been but will not be, or grieving over what used to be but will never be again. Most of us are in need of a place of quiet and calm in the midst of this busy season. Whatever it was that brought us here, we offer it to you, mighty God. You who were born frail and innocent in Bethlehem's stable, that we might know of your great and unending love. We know that there is no pain that does not echo in your heart, O God, and no joy that does not come from your hand. We trust that through all the shadows of this world, there yet shines the light of your love. In our darkness and in the darkness of this world, may your light continue to shine, bringing peace, bringing hope, bringing strength, bringing love, and bringing the sweetest gift to us all and to all who are in need. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, the sweetest gift, God with us. We heard David earlier play the Huron Carol. Well, we're going to hear him again now. And this time David is joined with his friend, La Kong Phi, who is a world-renowned cellist. And we will hear them play a beautiful piece for those who find this particular time of year difficult. It's called The Sweetest Gift.
Christmas really hurts this time.
Thank you, David, and thank you, Lac Hong. As many of you know, David is our director of church music here, and he's also head of music at Beale and the head of the London Singers. They've all been sort of bounced around, but David has had to learn to roll with the punches, and he's been incredible for us here at St. Aidan's in the midst of that. And Lac Hong is a teacher in the Thames Valley Board as well. But a brilliant musician, a little well-known fact, I bet, to some, but he toured with Deep Purple, folks. So that's an incredible thing. So we're glad to have this sort of talent here with us tonight. The next thing that's going to happen is a poem. And so I just want to say a word about two pieces of music that will happen in the midst of the poem, actually, partway through. One is Silent Night by Mark Smith. And many of you know Mark because Greg is honorary assistant here, and Mark is his spouse, and Mark is also incredibly good to us. He played with us throughout the summer. He's often here to play our funerals when they're midweek and David is in school. We all know the kind of gift that Mark brings to music as well, and we all love him here, and it's been a joy to be able to see him more often with when we had our in-person worship, and he was freed up and able to be here. So we're really thrilled. He's a couple beautiful pieces of music for us, and you'll hear the, one of them now. Also singing partway throughout this poem will be Aaron Smythe. And Aaron is a child of this parish, as many of you know, Jim and Sue Smythe's daughters. Aaron and Lynn are both incredible singers and both recorded for tonight as well. So she will be singing the First Noel, and you'll hear that. Absolutely beautiful. These girls, every time I go on Facebook, I see they're singing somewhere else. They're in competitions. They're just amazing. What great gifts have come from this beautiful parish. So you'll hear a couple of those in the midst of this poem.
Standing in the background, Tom Schumann. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had born a son. And she named him Jesus. Matthew 1, 24 to 25. Standing in the background. We usually find him stuck, back in the corner of the crush. He may be kneeling, he may be standing. He may appear as if he has a rather stunned look on his face. And in the Christmas pageant at most churches, he never has any lines to say, never gets a solo, never has the spotlight turned on him. Poor Jesus. Poor Joseph, sorry. And how much poorer we are, because we believe that Joseph has no role to play, no big part, nothing to say or sing during the holiest of days. Oh, we convince ourselves that we don't need to pay any attention to him, or shouldn't. Because we whisper behind our hands, just as his neighbors probably did, he's not really the father of the child. He's just a bystander, a person to ignore, a character actor who appears just for a moment and then is forgotten. But is there any better person to model trust for us? Sure, he could have easily dismissed what had been told to him one night as a despicable dream caused by all of rich food at the office party. Yet Joseph saw it as his calling and decided that he would do whatever it was God was asking him to do. Couldn't we use a little more trust in our lives, in our communities, in our world, in our churches right now, and courage? Imagine to stand up to family, friends, drinking buddies, and probably even strangers who had heard only the gossip, and simply say, perhaps over and over, whatever, I stand by Mary. I believe her. I love her. I will marry her. I will help her raise this child. Couldn't we use the reminder that courage is a trait we need as we move into these unknown moments? A new job, a new year, children, retirement, downsizing? What about his lifelong commitment to Mary, to Jesus, to the rest of the kids who came along? He could have become an absentee father. He could have been one of those dads constantly being searched for to pay child support. But he goes about his job working long hours, providing for Mary and the family, helping to put food on the table and a roof over their heads. He reminds us of our calling to get up out of bed each morning and simply go about doing all the day-to-day stuff we do as fathers and mothers, as teachers and volunteers, as friends and neighbors, all those little insignificant tasks we take on while standing in the background, no one noticing us, but making all the difference in the world to someone. This year, let's reach back into that shadowy corner of the crash where we have stuck him and move Jesus up to the manger where he belongs.
Thank you, Morgan. I apologize, folks. I got a little ahead of myself there when I was telling you about that poem and the two pieces of music. That poem called The Christmas Truce is coming up, I promise. But before that, of course, we had a reading from Morgan, and we have a beautiful piece of music called Winter Star, which shone over that manger scene. It's being performed by our own Ian Stevenson, producer of the Vicar's Crossing podcast, musical gifts extraordinaire, and just an overall brilliant young man. So I give you now Ian Stevenson, Winter Star.
Winter star up in the sky, looking down on earth tonight. And how I wonder, do you see the way your light has guided me? For you were there when he was born, on that first Christmas morn. You led three kings to Bethlehem, and you still lead us to him. 'Cause you're the light of love and peace, shining bright for the world to see. And when the night gets cold and dark, you lead us home, winter star. And I remember as a child, keeping warm by the fire. And there you were upon the tree, always watching over me. 'Cause you're the light of a loving peace, shining bright for the world to see. When the night gets cold and dark, you lead us home, winter star. You lead us home, star. 'Cause you're the light of love and peace, shining bright for the world to see. I saw a winter star.
Woo! Sweet.
Well, Ian has a cheering section. Not everybody gets a cheering section, but Ian has a cheering section. Almost missed him out. Thank you, Ian. Now, I don't want to have the joy that I see in that face. That's what I want in my life for sure. So this piece of poetry is called The Christmas Truce. And I'm just going to make sure I've got our readers ready.
Christmas Eve, in the trenches of France, the guns were quiet. The dead lay still in no man's land. Freddy, Franz, Friedrich, Frank. The moon like a medal hung in the clear, cold sky. Silver frost on barbed wire, strange tinsel, sparkled and winked. A boy from Stroud stared at a star to meet his mother's eyesight there. An owl swooped on a rat on the glove of a corpse. In a copse of trees behind the lines, a lone bird sang. A soldier poet noted it down. A robin holding his winter ground. Then silence spread and touched each man like a hand. Somebody kissed the gold of his ring. A few lit pipes, most in their great coats huddled, waiting for sleep. The liquid mud had hardened at last in the freeze. But it was Christmas Eve. Believe, belief. Thrilled the night air, where glittering rime on unburied suns treasured their stiff hair. The sharp, clean, midwinter smell held memory. On watch, a rifleman scoured the terrain. No sign of life. No shadows, shots from snipers, not to note or report. The frozen foreign fields were acres of pain. Then flickering flames from the other side danced in his eyes as Christmas trees in their dozens shone, candlelit on the parapets. And they started to sing all down the German lines.
Men who would drown in mud, be gassed or shot or vaporized by falling shells or live to tell, heard for the first time then, Stille Nacht, Heilige Nacht, alles schläft, einsam wacht.
Holy night, holy night.
Caria, the song was a sudden bridge from man to man, a gift to the heart from home or childhood, someplace shared. When it was done, the British soldiers cheered. A Scotsman started to bawl the first Noel, and all joined in, till the Germans stood, seeing across the divide, the sprawled, muted shapes of those who had died.
The first Noel, they're from Merry Christmas.
All night along the Western Front they sang, the enemies, carols, hymns, folk songs, anthems, in German, English, French, each battalion choired in its grim trench. So Christmas dawned, wrapped in mist, to open itself and offer the day like a gift for Harry, Hugo, Herman, Henry, Heinz, with whistles, waves, cheers, shouts, laughs. Frohe Weihnachten, Tommy. Merry Christmas, Fritz. A young Berliner brandishing schnapps was the first from his ditch to climb. A Shropshire lad ran at him like a rhyme. Then it was up and over, every man, to shake the hand of a foe as a friend, or slap his back like a brother would, exchanging gifts of biscuits, tea, manioc stew, tickler's jam, for cognac, sausages, cigars, beer, sauerkraut, or chase six hares who jumped from a cabbage patch, or find a ball and make of it a battleground, a football pitch. I showed him a picture of my wife. Ich zeigte ihm ein Foto meiner Frau. Sie sei schön, sagte er. He thought her beautiful, he said. They buried the dead man, hacked spades into earth again and again, till a score of men were at rest, identified, blessed. Der Herr ist mein Hirt, my shepherd I shall not want. And all that marvelous festive day and night, they came and went, the officers, the rank and file, their fallen comrades side by side, beneath the makeshift crosses of midwinter graves, beneath the shivering, shy stars and the pinned moon and the yawn of history, the high, bright bullets which each man later only aimed at the sky.
Thank you, Catherine, Ann, and Susan, and Mark and Aaron. Your gifts are so beautiful. You should hear Mark and Aaron when they get together. They produce incredible music together, too. It's my pleasure to welcome Lauren Han, Nee George, who's a great, great niece of mine and my goddaughter, our niece from Newfoundland, who was just recently married and has beautiful Callie, her little girl. And she recorded a couple of pieces for tonight. And this one is reflective of the poem that you just heard. It's called Beaulieu Wood. Thank you.
saints, men, and king, singer of
crying, you are. Thank you, Lauren. Love you, sweetheart. Aunt Catherine Ann and I are so proud of you. And thank you for that beautiful piece of music. One of the greatest storytellers I've come to know in these last few years is Elsbeth Dobman. Some of you will know Elsbeth. She's the daughter of what is his name again? No, I'm kidding. Gary and Nancy Dobman. And she is an incredible human being, a very strong advocate for those with autism. She's taken on everybody right up to Doug Ford. If you ever get a chance to be in her company, get her to tell you her version of Jonah and the Whale. It's incredible. In the meantime, she has a story she's written and will share with us now. And I just gotta, let's see, Elsbeth. She must be on with Nancy because she's not coming up. Nancy and Gary has to unmute. This is a piece that she's calling Letters to David, Christmas at Home. David is someone she often writes to. It's a space and a place and time. We can hear you now, folks.
Dear David, I got my first ever Christmas bonus from work. It came in a white envelope with my name on it, and I tucked it into my pocket of my jeans to hold onto until the end of the workday. I remembered hearing somewhere that opening gifts in front of the person who had given them right away is rude. Is that true? In any case, I didn't want to risk it. Every now and then, through the rest of my work hours, I remembered the envelope tucked into my pocket and let myself imagine what was inside. I had never had a job over the holidays before, so I was not sure what to expect. I didn't let myself open it until I'd gotten all the way home. The Christmases at our house are celebrated with a capital C. The days leading up to the 24th are all church services and baking, cards and invitations unfolded over loud choruses of Handel's Messiah. When I was younger, David, Christmas Eve was a church service before driving on to my uncle's house. Our boots squeaked on the snowy parking lot, the sky tossing down flakes against the orange street lamps that cast strange glows onto the underbellies of the clouds, cloudy night sky. The church was packed with many people, as there were in the city. Like Christmas reminded them that they should show up in their best coats and ties. They sat quietly in the hardwood pews. They listened to the sermons and even belted out a few "God rest ye merry gentlemen's" and "Hark the heralds" before disappearing like shadows into the night. We'd never see most of them again. Once it was over, they'd melt away with the snow stomped off heavy boots. They'd done their duty, showed up for Jesus' birthday. They were good, solemn Christians and could spend the rest of the year guilt-free, or at least until Easter. A birthday and a funeral. But my favorite Christmas was when we'd go to my aunt's house in the older part of town, inhabited by tall brick buildings with thin backyards and stretching front porches. The sun was long since sunk, the outside bitter cold, but inside warm and louder than a freight train's engine room. Dad's family was on better terms then, I think, or maybe I was just too little to understand that they weren't. Maybe we always had our problems, David. There weren't very many kids in the family and none around my age, so I was left to wander crowded rooms, unable to really settle in any of them for too long, and would soon get antsy despite my excitement to visit. The small kitchen with its stone floor was warm enough to be inviting, but no place for children, as you'd find yourself under the feet of relatives fussing over food and the oven and the fridge, the back door propped open for someone to light up a cigarette and pretend they were smoking it outside. Above us, the uncles and great uncles and the men smoked cigars in the upper room, the thick, sweet smoke filling the air as they talked. And when it was time to come down, my mom and uncle would sit in the corner, a drink in hand, and gossip about everyone else. There wasn't a quiet place in the house, not a one. And eventually my dad would take us out for a walk into the empty night, up and down the streets to get away from the noise and the smoke. Winter nights were still. The snow muffled the distant traffic and carrying sound until there was only the stillness and colored lights reflected off snow. Above us, Orion was somewhere stalking the night sky. Come spring, he would travel to hunt other skies, but even in the city, I could still see him. I wonder where you are right now, David.
Thank you, Elspeth. Two pieces of music. I introduced Dean to you earlier, my old schoolmate, and Ian, my producer nowadays. And so right now, they're going to a couple of pieces from them back to back. The first one is called The Gift, which many of you, if you listen to the Ennis Sisters from Newfoundland, you will know. And I don't need to tell you what the second one is. I think you'll know it when you hear it.
Was walking to market one day. She stopped for a rest by the roadside, where a bird with a broken wing lay. A few moments passed till she saw it, for its feathers were covered in sand. But soon cleaned and wrapped, it was traveling in the warmth of Maria's small hand. She happily gave her last peso down a cage made of rushes and twine. She fed it loose corn from the market and watched it grow stronger with time. Now the Christmas Eve service was coming, and the church shone with tinsel light, and all of the town folks brought presents to lay by the manger that night. There were diamonds and incense and perfumes, packages fit for a king. But one rigged bird in a small cage, Maria had nothing to bring. She waited till just before midnight, so no one can see her go in. And crying, she knelt by the manger, for her gift was unworthy to him. Then a voice spoke to her through the darkness, Maria, what brings you to me? If the bird in the cage is your offering, open the door, let me see. Though she trembled, she did as he asked her, and out of the cage the bird flew, soaring into the rafters on a wing that had healed good as new. Then just the midnight bell started ringing out, and the little bird started to sing a song that no words could recapture, whose beauty was fit for a king. Now Maria felt bliss just to listen to the cascades of notes speeding along, as her offering was lifted to heaven by the very first nightingale's song. Thank you.
Good King Wenceslas looked out on the feast of Stephen, when the snow lay round about, deep and crisp and even. Brightly shone the moon that night, though the frost was cruel. When the poor men came in sight, gathering winter fuel. Hither, page, and stand by me, if thou knowest telling. Yonder peasant, who is he? Where and what's his dwelling? Sire, he lives a good league hence, underneath the mountain, right against the forest fence, by St. Agnes Fountain. Bring me flesh and bring me wine, bring me pine logs hither. Thou and I shall see him dine when we bear them thither. Page and monarch, forth they went together, through the rude wind's wild lament and the bitter weather. Sire, the night is darker now, stronger. Fails my heart, I know not how, I can go no longer. Mark my footsteps, my good page, tread thou in them boldly. Thou shalt find the winter's rage freeze thy blood less coldly. In his master's steps he trod, where the snow lay dinted. Heat was in the very sod which the saint had printed. Therefore all good men be sure, wealth or rank possessing, ye who now now will bless the poor, shall yourselves find blessing. Good King Wenceslas last looked out on the feast of Stephen, when the snow lay round about, deep and crisp and even. Brightly shone the moon that night, though the frost was cruel. When the poor men came in sight, gathering winter fuel.
The man really does have a fan club. I'm impressed that he got a wardrobe change in since his last performance. He's got a different shirt and he's wearing a hat. So that's impressive. We love you, Ian. Thank you very much.
This next piece comes from Tom Schumann. Tom is an associate member of the Aota community. He's also a retired priest from just across the Lake Erie in Ohio. It's called You Came. You came. You could have come as warrior, ready to take us on, one at a time or en masse. You could have come a whirlwind, swirling, twirling, twisting around us, flinging us up into the air. You could have come with a bag of chocolates in one hand and a timeout chair in the other. You came a tiny, vulnerable baby, lungs screaming for life, fingers grasping for something to hold on to, your whole being completely depending on us to feed you, change you, clothe you, protect you, love you, and we were gobsmacked.
Our next performance is by Gabriel Heidinger. Gabriel is minister at the United Church in Dorchester. She's from here in London. She's also a very gifted soloist, a vocal performer who is just incredible. And she is going to sing Lo, Ehre, Rose, Ehre, Blooming in German. I would say it in German for you, but I do not want to pull a muscle. So I give you Gabrielle.
Hello, I'm Gabrielle Heidinger, and I'm here to sing for you today in the beautiful Huron Chapel on this long journey through the dark to the glorious light that is coming at the end of Advent. This is a traditional German carol, Es ist ein Rosensprungen, or Lo, how a rose ere blooming. Es ist ein Rosensprungen aus eine Wurzelzart, wie uns die alten Sonnen von Essig kam die und hat ein Blümlein gebracht, mit ihm im kalten Winter, wohl zu der halben Nacht. Das Röslein, das ich meine, davon Jesajas sagt, ist Maria die Reine, die uns das Blümlein bracht, aus Gottes ewigem Rat, hat sie ein Kind geboren.
Mary reflects. It wasn't what we'd hoped for. I'll begin again. Mary reflects. It wasn't what we'd hoped for. Joseph's grand idea. I was not liked by all, but loved by some at the village well. Judgment was strong while I carried peaceful dark in my womb. Joseph knew grief, but he said, leave all the gossip, the drip born of small faith, watered from shallow wells, tainted with pain from the common earth of our souls. The village talked. We left for the house of bread, where he'd got people not counting the months nor years, not then. The doors seemed shut against us as busy lives went on, with Joseph doing casual work below the counter and his skills. The promise of ages, of prophecy, coming to give us our freedom was silent. So the birth came. As births come, then the temple and the cleansing and redemption. That 40th day we walked to Jerusalem with country women with baskets, old men with olives, young men with passes, schoolgirls with dreams, delayed by the system, but hoping to walk home by nightfall. A day's walk, a long road through every barrier we make to reach the temple of the Lord. It was a sight beyond our senses, the noise and the swearing, buildings, construction and traffic, armed soldiers in courts of the Gentiles, and women and tradesmen and tourists and trampling. Then two old angels spoke, now let your servant go in peace, having seen our salvation and made us welcome. My child was welcome in the courts of the Lord. Two birds dropped from the wind, two blessings left our sacrifice of sore feet, warmed with wisdom, a light to enlighten the Gentiles and give glory to your people, Israel.
Thank you, Pat. This next piece of music takes us to the other Smythe sister, Lynn, who's also a beautiful voice, a beautiful performer. She is going to sing for us, Mary, Did You Know?
Baby boy would see. A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
We pray for those who, like Mary, have made a definite choice. Those who, despite their fears, have deliberately given their yes to God. We give thanks for the folk who gave us life, who nurtured us with encouragement and criticism. We give thanks for the folk around us today who shape our opinions and reform our character and enable us to grow in even more love. And God, will you help us if we have said yes to you? And will you give us the strength and the determination to see the job through? Once again, my great niece is back to sing Mary's Lullaby, and that will be immediately followed by our friend Matt Martin. Matt is the rector of Trinity Church in Lucan. He is an incredible priest and a fine human being whose love is for others is just evident by his very walk, and he will sing "O Little Town of Bethlehem."
Day will come. come, you'll be a king. Stand with gifts in hand inside the stable door and listen to young Mary sing, helped by the heavenly choir. They see the love upon her face and hear her heavenly song. Then tenderly she tucks him in and slumberly yawns. Sleep, my precious baby, sleep among the cattle, goats, and sheep, with just a manger to lie in. The day will come, you'll be a king. The day will come, you'll be a king. Sleep, my precious baby, sleep among the cattle, goats, and sheep, with just a manger to lie in. The day will come, you'll be a king. The day will come, you'll be a king.
Oh, little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above, while mortals sleep, angels keep their watch of wandering love. Oh, morning stars together proclaim thy holy birth, and praises sing to God the King, and peace men on earth. Oh, little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by.
Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight.
Reading from the Gospel of Luke. Let us praise the Lord, the God of Israel. He has come to the help of his people and has set them free. He has provided for us a mighty Savior, a descendant of his servant David. He promised through his holy prophets long ago that he would save us from our enemies, from the power of all those who hate us. He said he would show mercy to our ancestors and remember his sacred covenant. With a solemn oath to our ancestor Abraham, he promised to rescue us from our enemies and allow us to serve him without fear, so that we might be holy and righteous before him all the days of our life.
We interrupt your regularly scheduled programming with some breaking good news this evening. You see, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. We go now live to our Galilee correspondent in Bethlehem, Ken Eastwood, with that story. Thanks, Ken. Yes, Joseph went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, quote, "Do not be afraid. I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." End quote. "And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors.' When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, quote, 'Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us.'" End quote. "So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them." Ken Eastwood, reporting live, Bethlehem. Thanks, Ken. Good news indeed. We now return you to your regularly scheduled and highly entertaining programming.
What child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthem sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear, for sinners here the silent word is pleading. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold, and myrrh, the peasant king, to own him, the King of Kings, salvation brings, and loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of our Savior was born upon this day.
to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Tidings of comfort and joy. From God our heavenly Father a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. Now that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Tidings of comfort and joy.
Well, that surprise newscaster was CJBK's local CJBK news morning show, Ken Eastwood. And he had a little musical trick up his sleeve as well. So we thank him for interrupting our regularly scheduled programming to bring us the story of Jesus, word for word from the Bible, as delivered from one of our local newscasters. Thank you, Ken. Brilliant. And thank you, Mark, for the beautiful What Child Is This? And Josie, Away in a Manger. Just about to the end now, folks. It's been a long evening, but I guess the question is, what else were you going to do tonight? We're in COVID time. Anyway, one last piece for me to read, a beautiful piece of music from Matt Martin. I'll give a couple of closing remarks and then a postlude. Here is a cross. Here is a cross. A sign of the love of the life of a man who shows us the way that God loves. Here is a woman who said yes to God and carried the baby who grew to a man and showed us the way that God loves. Here is an old man who worked with his hands and hammered the wood, who cared for the woman who carried the baby who grew to a man who showed us the way that God loves. This is the landlord in Bethlehem town who saw that they had traveled a very long way and lent them a shed with some hay for a bed, where the old man who worked with his hands cared for the woman who gave birth to the baby who grew to a man who showed us the way that God loves. These are the shepherds out in the weathers who heard the good news and came running down to Bethlehem town to find in the shed the landlord had lent just an old man who worked with his hands and cared for the woman who cared for her baby who grew to a man and showed us the way that God loves. These are the poor people, all sad and afraid and ill and alone, who saw the good news in the life of a man who showed us the way that God loves. These are the children who wanted to play, more joyful than grown-ups who chased them away, who found they belonged very close to the man who showed us the way that God loves. You are the people who share the good news of the small children who come to belong, and the poor people who found that they were free, and the rough shepherd who glorified God, and all busy people who find a small place for the old man who worked with his hands, and the young woman who said yes to God, and that baby boy who grew to be a man and carried a cross and showed us the way that God loves.
Night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth.
world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angels' voices, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born, oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. Break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord, the name forever praise we.
I want to take this opportunity now to say thank you to all who offered their gifts and talents tonight, to Lynn Smythe, Lauren Han, Matt Martin, Dean Reed, Aaron Smythe, Josie Bidevine, Gabrielle Heidinger, Lak Hong Fei, Mark Smith, Kate and Amelia Anderson, Ken Eastwood, Elsbeth Dobman, David Weaver, Ian Stevenson, and all of you who took some of the prayers or stories tonight to share as well from St. Aidan's Church. Thank you to all of you. The resources that we use to build tonight, the different stories and prayers are all but the poem are from Iona, from either Walking Through Advent, which is a resource, or Christmas Eve at the Diner, the Big Book of Worship. I think the other one's called Hay at the Stable. I just can't remember. But they're all Wild Goose publications, which are available to you at quite reasonable prices. So please check those out as well. Merry Christmas to you. Catherine Ann is on here as well. And I know on her behalf, I can say that we love you all and we thank you for joining us. We hope you can join us. There she is. We hope you can join us on Christmas Eve at 4 p.m. for a service of lessons and carols. Nancy, Gary, can you mute yourself, please? Just a thank you to everyone, and I hope you can all come online on Christmas Eve, 4 p.m. Come a little early. We're going to sing some carols. Catherine Ann and David will share the music. Myself and Ann will do some readings. We'll have a beautiful service of Christmas Eve as best we can apart. Stay safe, wash your hands, wear your mask, keep your distance, and stay home. We put a little note on the sign that said, if you're having trouble staying home, try shaving your eyebrows, okay? That'll look after it. You won't want to go out then. So bless you to all of you. Thank you for tonight. It's been beautiful. We have one more piece of music, which is for you to sign off to. And again, I thank David for this and his friend, Larry Farquharson. They played a beautiful piece of music, which you'll all know. And it's called Sleigh Ride. Does that sound right? Do you know that piece? Let's have a listen. Good night, all. Turn your cameras on and dance. Let's do it right. Come on. There we go. Turn. Gary swaying like he's at a high school dance. Hey, Matt, let's see those moves, buddy. Look at Ian. dancing, baby. Here you go, Billy. How you're dancing. Don't just stop the screen, you move. I think Jim Smythe is on there. I want to see Jim's moves. I see my niece Sarah down there. Come on, Sarah. Turn on the camera and show us your moves. Oh, look at Ron and Josie are doing it. All and to all a good night.